Welcome to your Sunday edition of Collider Mailbag. I'm Perry. That's Mark Reilly. I'm happy to be here. Are you happy to be here?
I'm happy to be here. It's Sunday. It's Mailbag. It's time to answer questions. I like this.
We have some good ones today, too. This first one comes from Mazin, who writes, "Hello, Collider crew. I just saw the new trailer for All the Money in the World, and this trailer seems to have a very different tone than the first one. The first trailer felt like a drama based on true events with some unique characters, while the second trailer felt more like a dramatic action thriller that's inspired by true events. I guess my question is, why are the two trailers very different, and what should we expect from the movie? Is the change of cast the reason for the change of tone, or do you think the movie was always headed this way? Thanks for choosing my question." Riley, what do you think about that? Did you watch both trailers?
I've watched both trailers. I spoke about this on Movie Talk when this trailer dropped, and I think I know why, because there is a very different tone. Now, I do believe that this was always like a crime thriller, kind of drama thriller based on true events, but this trailer, this new trailer with Christopher Plummer, actually shows that. The first trailer, though, they were going all in on Kevin Spacey for an Oscar campaign. That was what I noticed from that trailer. I even talked about it when the original trailer came out and we saw Kevin Spacey in the makeup. It focused on him more. It gave a little bit more time to breathe and show his performance, because what I felt was happening was they were gonna mount an Oscar campaign for Kevin Spacey. We know what happened there. So now we have Christopher Plummer, and he kind of just folded in nicely, and it looks like an ensemble piece now with less focus on Christopher Plummer's character, and I think that's by design. They wanna get rid of that, you know, all that nonsense with Kevin Spacey and focus on the true story. And not really focus on anybody else. Maybe Michelle Williams a little bit. I can see that she's acting her, you know, her butt off, because I can't wait to see her in this movie especially. But that's why I think they're doing it. I think they really want to focus on the story and get away from all the drama that happened with Kevin Spacey.
No, that's a very fair point. And it is something that crossed my mind too. Not necessarily just with an Oscar campaign for Kevin Spacey, but just with the movie overall. But yeah. First thing, just to look at one side of it versus the other, which is what Riley was just discussing, is when you have trailers for movies like these, and when you have trailers for really any movie at all, they can't be carbon copies of each other, because what you want to do with a trailer is you want to appeal maybe to the movie-going audience that your movie is for, and then you want to have a wider appeal so you make some more money. So the trailers just can't be the exact same thing.
Sure.
So this, to me, makes me think maybe this was the route they were going to go no matter what, and they were going to focus on something a little different than they did the first time around. But given recent events, there's no ignoring that that could have affected it. And I'm wondering if maybe what happened makes them think, okay, it's not worth putting so much behind an Oscar campaign, no matter who they're pushing for, and instead, let's just focus on making this as profitable and getting the most people to see it as possible.
Yeah.
But I don't know, if that were the case, then why would they rush to deliver it so early so that they could qualify for award season rather than just taking time? Then you got to think that the other, I believe it's a series on FX that covers the same topic.
Right.
That comes into play. But really, I think what it comes down to for me is, one way or the other, I think we were getting a drastically different trailer, but it is very interesting how it approaches that role, because you do have that build up to the reveal of Kevin Spacey in the first trailer.
Mm-hmm.
You do get something similar in the second trailer, but it most definitely is not as pronounced.
Right.
So, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they're saying, oh, we thought that one was going to get an Academy Award, but now we're pushing that aside. That, to me, is also a sign of, let's not shove this in people's faces, because that's not why we did what we did. We did, because I had written a quote from Ridley Scott down that I thought was great, and now, of course, I can't find the exact line, but it was, oh, here it is. "We cannot let one person's action affect the good work of all these other people. It's that simple." And really, I think that's a great quote, and that's what I admired most about that news, that they were just going to replace him in that role.
Yeah, and with any marketing campaign, they're going to show you different looks and give you different teases, you know, what you can expect. So maybe the first time was to showcase Kevin Spacey, kind of put some Oscar out there. But now we're getting not only Christopher Plummer to show that, you know, he's out of there, which is, it seems seamless for me, that inclusion of Plummer. But you want to know what the movie's about. You want to get a sense of the tone, and that's what I got from this newest trailer. It looks fantastic.
Yeah, I cannot wait to see this one.
Yeah.
All right, moving on to question number two from Avrian, who writes, Hello, Collider crew. I have heard from many Collider crew members that an Oscar campaign is expensive, but I don't see how that could be. I thought the committee just viewed great movies that had been released in theaters and then picked 10 that the committee agrees upon that should be Best Picture. Will you be able to take the time and explain what all goes into an Oscar campaign to make it so expensive? Love watching y'all every day. Keep up the great work, and thanks so much for taking my question. Well, first, when we were discussing some of these questions getting started for Mailbag, Reilly brought up that we had done a crash course on how Oscar nominees are chosen, specifically for the Best Picture category. And right. If you're curious about that, please go back and look for that video, because I think that is probably my favorite crash course video we ever made. And that was with a great assist from Adam Chitwood from Collider.com. So do check that out if that's something you're interested in. But with paying for an Oscar campaign, it's really expensive for a number of reasons, and those reasons might include digital screeners, hard copy screeners to go out, because the studio has to pay for those. They have special luncheon events, they have cocktail receptions, they host screenings with Q&As, so you also have to consider with those Q&As, they have to pay to fly the talent all over the country, if not the world, to promote their movie and to go for awards consideration. All that stuff adds up, and all of it can be really vital for something that, you know, let's say isn't backed by a studio with all the money in the world to spend on that. Oh, see what I kind of did there?
Oh.
Yeah, I didn't do that on purpose.
So. I get it now.
Yeah, so if a movie doesn't have millions of dollars to spend, because I did read something, I believe it was from Variety, where they estimated that it can cost $3 to $10 million to host an Oscar campaign. And sometimes that could be vital, because when you think about this, I mean, I say it all the time when we're reviewing movies too, is that We're human beings, and human beings only have so many hours in the day. Human beings have specific interests. And I might say to myself, oh, you know, just knowing nothing about these movies, one movie might look more appealing to me than another. But then all of a sudden I start to hear Oscar buzz about the other. And I'm like, oh, even though I wasn't that interested, I should watch it to be informed. And sometimes an Oscar campaign can fill that gap. So if, let's say, a movie is not on your radar and all of a sudden you're invited to a luncheon or you get a screening invite, you might be more inclined to see that movie, and then you are informed on that movie and you might vote for that movie. So it's important.
Yeah, I can't really add much to that. You nailed it. It's an expensive thing. If you live in LA, you know they put up billboards for these movies.
Yeah.
They're everywhere for your consideration.
Three billboards.
Yeah, three billboards. Hey, you did it again. They're everywhere.
You're
driving down. It was funny. It worked for me. You know, you're driving down Highland on your way home, and there's Call Me By Your Name for consideration. You're driving, there's Wonder Woman for your consideration. They're really going, yes, Warner Brothers can really, it has some money behind them for maybe a Wonder Woman campaign. Mm-hmm. Fox now with the National Board of Review, Logan made the top 10 list, so we might see some four-year consideration from Fox for Logan. This is the time. We're going to see a lot of these things. The digital screeners, the screeners, the deliveries, the luncheons, everything. We're not even getting to the nominations yet. Once the nominations are announced, then there's even more campaigning that's happening.
Yeah.
More luncheons, more this or that. I mean, it's a huge undertaking.
There's definitely more campaigning to be had once the nominations are out, but I actually think that's where rules come into play, then they hit the point where they're limited on what they can do, and I think things like luncheons are actually taken out of the equation. That's not allowed once the nominations are announced, which makes a lot of sense when, you know, you got to consider playing fair in things like these, because ultimately, it's the movie that should earn the nomination more so than anything else, but a campaign can offer a nice assist to something that doesn't have the limelight at the moment.
So you wouldn't take a free lobster dinner and then vote for the Best Picture?
Come on. You know,
lobster, steak and lobster dinner, I'll vote for Logan.
Send me lobster, that's actually, don't send me lobster. That's a weird thing to do.
Yeah.
No, thank you. I just want my DVDs.
I see you getting a cooler now of live lobsters.
I mean,
send it to Perri. They won't send it to me.
I think one of the things that have become my favorite to get in the mail is I'm a member of the BFCA, for example, and one of the things you get in the mail is you get copies of the screenplays.
That's cool.
That fascinates me more so than anything, is just having, because really that's one thing that's interesting to consider when you're casting a vote, is you watch a movie and yes, you can assess the screenplay from that standpoint, but then when you're actually reading a hard copy And yeah, you could picture the visuals that you might have just seen, but when you take that out of the equation and you're just sitting there reading a script, because you don't really get the chance to do that very often. So
it's a fascinating process. Yeah. As a writer, I love it. Go out and read scripts. Yeah. You will learn so much.
If you get the chance.
Yeah, if you can. Yeah.
All right, so number three comes from David Alexander, who writes, "Hey guys, big fan from Orlando, Florida. I've been thinking about Disney's short films, Toy Story, Mini Stories, Olaf Adventures, etc., and was wondering if Star Wars would ever cave into that trend, maybe a BB-8 and R2-D2 squabble, and can it premiere on Disney's streaming service?" Reilly, do you want a Disney Star Wars short to play before a Star Wars feature?
I mean, sure. That's fine, but they're already doing it with Forces of Destiny. It's out there. They're making these little vignettes that focus on the female characters in the Star Wars universe. I see more of that happening. They could do a BB-8 R2-D2 squabble, playing before a movie. Maybe I always go to Pixar. Pixar does their shorts, which I love. God, I love those shorts. However, I hear the Olaf Frozen Adventure before Coco, people are like, "Why is this thing
there's 21 minutes?" A lot of negativity.
There's some negativity to that because I think people want to see Coco. We're not talking about a Pixar short like Piper, which was so damn cute. And it's like 3 minutes. It's like 3 or 4 minutes before the movie. So you're like, okay, that we can get behind that. But when you're talking 21 minutes, that's another mailbag for another time. I would never say never. You never know where this is going to go. Sure, they could probably do something on the streaming service. Vignettes maybe before the theater. I don't know. I think look at Forces of Destiny as the template. I think that's what Disney will ultimately do to spread the good Star Wars word. Maybe not in theaters like Pixar does, or especially the Olaf's Frozen Adventure. We're not gonna get a 20-minute short before a Star Wars movie. The Star Wars movie is the main course, so I don't think they would maybe go down that line. Again, Forces of Destiny, I think, is the template they're looking at.
I think that Star Wars would have a bigger challenge ahead of them if they were to include shorts before their features. It just, this is a weird thing to articulate. It just doesn't feel right to me. Maybe it's because Pixar had established that precedent and I just became used to the fact, I'd get my nice little short before the movie. Actually, I mentioned this on a previous mailbag, but during my press screening of Coco, they never played the Frozen short, so I never saw it.
Good.
But I've heard all of the negativity about it, and it does seem a little ridiculous to me to play a short that is that long before a movie when the focus really should be on the feature film, and all of a sudden that's pissing people off and it's taking away so much attention, especially when those are geared towards families and young moviegoers have attention spans that are just so long. You don't want to ruin the feature that way.
That's such a great point. They're coming in. They want to see Coco.
Yeah.
They want to see Frozen, and this is a marketing campaign. This is Disney going, don't forget, we got Frozen 2 coming.
Yeah.
And I get that, but why do you make that so long?
I don't know. Yeah. To veer back towards Star Wars, though, if they started to do that and make that a thing where every time you saw a Star Wars feature film on the big screen, you expected a short film before it, then they have to deal with the idea of canon, which Pixar doesn't really have to adhere to, even though there are theories out there that everything's connected. But with something like Star Wars, and also the thing that you suggest, David, with BB-8 and R2-D2 having a squabble, that sounds to me like a cutesy kid-friendly short to place before it. It doesn't really fit tonally with what I think they're going for. And then also, does that add to Star Wars canon? Because that is a thing that they have to worry about as well. The Disney streaming service seems like a proper space to explore the short format, which is a fascinating format because we're so used to being able to tell epic stories over the course of 2 hours. Mm-hmm. Really, telling a story between 5 to 15 minutes is just this crazy challenge, and I'm always in awe of filmmakers that pull it off so well. But with the Forces of Destiny, I've liked some of them.
Yeah.
I mean, I like all of them, I would say, but I haven't really loved them.
Me too. Yeah, I haven't been over the moon for them, but they're just, you know, they're geared for a younger audience.
Yeah.
They really are, and I think that's where it's landing and landing well. So, but yeah, in the end, I don't think Star Wars will go down that line. It's hard to qualify, like you said, but it doesn't feel right. It just doesn't feel right to put a Star Wars short, live action or animated, before a Star Wars movie. We just want to get, like, seriously, when you're watching a Star Wars movie, for fans like us, I don't even want the trailers. I just go.
Yeah.
Just get me, I want that crawl. You want that moment. So I think as long as the Star Wars brand is popular, that's what we'll get, and there'll be little side things that we do. But yeah, canon's also a great point. Pablo Hidalgo right now is probably rolling over, going, no.
Oh, talking
He's
about
hysterical.
This so soon. I'm so excited. All right, question number four comes from Sam, who writes, everyone's trying to predict who's gonna die in Avengers Infinity War. Did the new trailer change your opinion? Spider-Man and Vision look like they'll be in tough spots. What do you think? Who are you predicting, and did the trailer change anything for you?
You know, the trailer didn't change anything for me. You know what? Actually, I think Vision does have as big a chance as anyone to die, and die pretty early on, because of we know he has an Infinity Stone. Mm-hmm. And we actually get a shot in the trailer of a scepter going into his head and him screaming. Now, what is he doing looking human? I don't know. I don't know what that is. Is that some alternate reality that he can access, or can he use his powers and change to being human? I don't know. I think Vision definitely might go. It's just a feeling.
Yeah.
But there's some bigger ones. Even Vision dying wouldn't be that shocking to me. It would be the big ones that we've been that are rumored now, and that's, you know, Steve Rogers, Captain America, Tony Stark, you know, the original Avengers. There's hints at it. I'm still thinking Captain America is going to die. He's going to save people, sacrifice himself somehow. There's precedent in the comic books that Falcon can take over, Bucky can take over. These are the two characters that have taken on the mantle of Captain America in the comics. I could see it doing the same thing in the movies. Spider-Man's safe. He's got Homecoming 2.
Yeah.
He's got Homecoming 2 coming in, so he's gonna make it out. that's just business.
No, yeah, that is a very valid point, which does kind of take Spider-Man out of the equation.
Yeah.
Clearly, he has a really intense-looking scene with Thanos, and then some people are predicting that shot of Tony Stark is him being sad after Spider-Man's died, and the only thing that I could think of with that is, remember in Ultron when he had that vision of everybody dying, so maybe that's a continuation of that. So
could be.
I don't
could
think
be.
Spider-Man's gonna die anyway. And really, with all the Avengers, I can kind of group them with, you know, old and new, and it would make you think that the new ones are the ones that are gonna continue on with the franchise, so I had kind of eliminated them.
Yeah.
And I had put my money on Hawkeye being the big one to die by the end of Infinity War, and then Cap being the one to die by the end of Avengers 4.
Yeah.
I do think Vision is at risk, though, because even though Vision is one of the newer Avengers, we've really only seen him in Age of Ultron. He's not that bit. It's like he feels like he has one foot in both sides of it. Mm-hmm. So I think he would be a good stepping stone to a bigger death, as sad as that sounds. But I'm also thinking that taking the Mind Stone out won't be what kills him, because maybe whatever that did is already in him.
Maybe.
I believe there's things in the comics where they can replace it with something else.
Yeah,
to have a new energy source, but.
Yeah, you never know. Maybe, you know, that stone gave him his power. Maybe that power is there to stay, and who knows? It will make sense. I'm sure it's going to be handled well. It's the Russo brothers. They know what they're doing. I trust him, you know? I do trust him, but we'll see. I'm as curious as you are, because I think there's some twists. I don't think we're all going to get, Vision could possibly live forever, you know? We might get new Avengers. It might be that Avengers 4 is New Avengers, or Avengers Assembled, or something. I don't know what the subtitle will be, but I can't wait to see this.
That trailer is great.
It's
something else.
It was great.
All right, moving on to our final question of the day, comes from Rexamillion, who writes, hey crew, so is it just my nostalgia playing tricks on me, or does it seem like the big dumb Hollywood summer blockbuster is getting worse over time? I remember seeing the first Independence Day film back when I was in high school and not liking it, thinking it was so campy and dumb, but after seeing films like Transformers and then going back to Independence Day, it's still dumb, yet enjoyable and entertaining because the characters are very likable. What do you guys think? I definitely think it's something about nostalgia and just where you are at that point in your life when a movie comes out, because specifically when I'm thinking about disaster films, clearly Independence Day was very important to me, and it was because, I think partially because of the age that I was at, because when I was young like that, I also got very obsessive. So when I saw something like Independence Day that I really loved, I would watch it over and over. And when you spend so many hours of your childhood watching the same movie, that movie never really leaves you. And I had done that with Independence Day and a little less so with Dante's Peak. I love Dante's Peak. And even when I revisit it now, like, yeah, I know it's cheesy and campy and silly, but those movies to me do have more heart than something like Transformers. Even whether I was a kid or an adult, I don't think I'd be able to make that same connection with some of the disaster movies I got as a kid. But really, to say that they're losing steam now isn't necessarily the case. We do get a lot of bad ones. The one that comes to mind is Pompeii, which was a steaming pile of garbage.
Yeah.
But, you know, I would say Geostorm is just passable. San Andreas wasn't that bad. San Andreas is an example to me that is really cheesy and silly and ridiculous, but it did have a lot of heart.
Yeah.
And The Rock had so much charisma that it would work. And then you also have to consider the fact that we've gotten great ones. Like, Cloverfield is a great disaster movie. And then also The Wave. I've spoken about The Wave many a times. Go see The Wave if you haven't.
The Wave is incredible. So good. That's a disaster pick, but that's a drama.
It's just
life and death. Oh, crazy. I guess, are you qualifying this as disaster movie?
That is kind of how I read it. When you say big, dumb Hollywood summer blockbusters, my mind immediately goes to disaster.
It usually is. I mean, you know, yeah, you could qualify the Transformers franchise as mentioned here. I mean, The Last Knight is just...
It's a headache.
Anyways, so with the, like, I loved Independence Day as well. I'm a little bit older than you, but that still landed with me very well. I loved it. The one movie that stands out to me is Jurassic World as big, dumb summer blockbuster.
Yeah.
But didn't land with me. I loved Jurassic World. I saw it opening night. I had a great time. The nostalgia is there. And maybe that's why I liked it, because, you know, the music and whatnot, I had these like great moments of like, oh, Jurassic Park, yeah. And I was remembering that time. I was kind of surprised when a lot of the critics were like, this is an awful movie. And I was like, really? Because I had a lot of fun with it. I know it's kind of dumb and kind of, you know, contrived with the kids and the sphere and whatnot and being kind of like, oh, you got to remove your brain. But I don't know, it's hard to say. I don't think Hollywood blockbusters are losing steam, because you can, if you take Hollywood blockbuster, I include Marvel in that,
yeah.
I include Star Wars in that, I include Logan in that, Wonder Woman.
So we're removing the words big dumb. Once we take big dumb out of the equation.
I mean, if you put big dumb Hollywood blockbusters, then your lists are right on the money, because that's where, like San Andreas, I was pleasantly surprised. I was like, it's kind of all right.
Yeah.
Transformers, it's just, I can't do it. They're here to stay, is what I'm saying. I think there's always going to be room for a big blockbuster in the summer that is kind of like, of your Transformers, of your San Andreas, of your Geostorms, of your Pompeys, you know, that just come out and you're like, okay, I want to see the effects. I want to see, you know, a bunch of people get wiped out by a tidal wave and then see what happens after. I don't know. There's going to be some that are going to get even worse, and there's going to be some that are going to land like San Andreas.
Yeah, I mean, it's the same case with any scale production in any genre, really.
Yeah.
I mean, you could basically apply this question to just about anything.
Yep.
All right, well, thank you guys so much for sending in some interesting, diverse questions. I think we covered a lot of topics today, and that always makes me feel good on a mailbag episode. So thank you guys so much for taking the time to send these in. If you want one of your questions addressed on this show or maybe an episode of Movie Talk, send it on over to collidervideo@gmail.com. Mark Reilly, where can everyone find you on the internet?
Find me at Reilly Round, Twitter and Instagram. We'll talk over there about movies.
Oh, yeah. And I am at Nemiroff on Twitter and Instagram. Please like, share, subscribe, all that good stuff. And we will see you bright and early Monday morning with a new episode of Movie Talk.